Good afternoon, Jal sir, and thank you very
good
much
afternoon.
For sharing time for me for this interaction, sir.
No, not at all. It's a pleasure and it's an honor for me to be being a part of this entire thing that you all have done. And thank you so much. Thanks a million.
Thanks, sir. Sir, I have always seen you to be very polite, calm and composed. Usually I've seen you in court and in your office as well. So were you the same during your childhood or were you notorious then?
I'll tell you one thing, Purvish, that on a professional level, yes, you may have seen me very cool, calm, composed. But otherwise, if you go and ask people who are quite close to me, they'll say that Jal and calm and composed is absolutely two, they are antonyms. They'll say that I'm opposite to cool, calm and composed. I'm known to be a very aggressive person. And characteristic of myself is that I am in life also quite aggressive, in the sense that aggressive, not in the sense of being violent or something like that. But I always believe in giving a fight. I don't like to give it up in any walks of life, be it professional, be it personal, or any walks of life. I believe to give a fight. And when you give a fight, I believe in being aggressive and giving the fight so that you give your best.
Nice. So this actually requires a great moral within yourself. How actually have you intrinsic such a moral in your personality?
I'll tell you very frankly that Purvish, being a professional and having a personal life, these two are really, really very different aspects of a lawyer's life.
Right, sir.
I believe that it is something like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Right. When you be a professional as a lawyer, you are given a duty to do a job for your client. And that is to be done with the utmost humility at your command.
Right.
I believe that my first endeavor is to see that I do the best for my client. Now, doing best may include being cool, being calm, being composed. And the most important thing in a lawyer's life is that apart from knowing the law, apart from knowing the facts of the case, one should know the court in which he is arguing. He should know the judge, what the judge actually likes, what the judge actually wants. And one most important thing that I would like to just point out here is for all junior lawyers that please, when you're arguing, in the midst of the argument, if a judge puts you a query, immediately stop there, listen to the query of the judge, and keep at the back of your mind what was the last point that you were arguing, but first answer the query of the judge. I feel that more often than not, what junior lawyers do is that in the zeal and zest to see to it that they don't forget their arguments, they first try to finish their arguments even before answering the query of the judge. But I feel that the first thing that one should do is listen carefully to what the judge wants actually. So that is one thing which is very important and which is. But as I said, that you asked me that how do you manage to keep calm and composed? But it's not something which has come to me overnight.
Right.
Initially, when I joined the profession, I was very aggressive towards the courts, and I was very young at that point of time. And in the endeavor to see that I put across my point, at times used to get impulsive and argue too. But by passage of time, I found out that no, being impulsive is not the order of the day. What one needs to do is be cool, calm, and patient while arguing. So that is how I have molded myself in this profession.
Sir, was choosing the profession of advocacy was always your passion?
No, I would. If I have to write an autobiography about myself, I will title it as an accidental lawyer. I'll tell you very frankly, I was actually an accidental lawyer. The reason being that when I joined actually LLB, the course of LLB, at that time there were three years course after BCom. I was playing for Gujarat University at that point of time. I joined the course of LLB only with a view to see that I play for another 3 years the university level, and then knock the doors of the Gujarat Ranji Trophy team. So, and then I get to play something good on a first class level, and then I would get a job in some bank. But luckily for me, as they say, the destiny takes you where you are supposed to go. Mr. KJ Setna, a very, very senior advocate, and I would say one of the doyens of on criminal side. He happens to be a very good family friend. So he told my father, I don't know why, but one day he told my father that I want your son to join me as a lawyer. So one day my father told me that, Jal, now that since you have completed your BCom, just go and meet Mr. Setna. So on the 15th of June, I remember the date very, very vividly, that on the 15th of June, 1992, I went to him in the morning at about 8:39 in a green t-shirt and a light blue jeans with, obviously at that time I had hair, but in long hair at that point of time. And he just said that, come and sit here. So I sat there for about half an hour, 45 minutes. And then he said that, come, we'll have lunch together. And it was just 10 o'clock. And I never had a habit of having lunch at 10. So I had lunch with him. He sat on my motorbike. I had a motorbike at that time. And told me to take it to the court. Now, coincidentally, 15th of June 1992 was the first day of Justice S. Nainar Sundaram as the Chief Justice of the Gujarat High Court. And I was walking behind him. I did not know the head or the tail of the legal faculty, the legal fraternity, the legal field, nothing that I knew about. So I kept on walking behind him. He had a bouquet in his hand. He went in the chamber of His Lordship Justice S. Nainar Sundaram, as he then was. And I went there and stood behind him. Then we came out of the chamber. And he said that, do you know who he is? I said, no, sir, I don't know who he is. And he said that he's the new Chief Justice of the Gujarat High Court from today. I said, wow. And that was the day when I saw actually the kind of respect, the kind of honor that comes to this post, a constitutional post called a High Court judge. Right. And that is where and when I decided that I want to become a High Court judge in future. Leave aside being lawyer, though I didn't know anything. I just told myself that if at all I become something in this profession, I want to become a High Court judge. So that was the triggering point, if I can say, which motivated me. And thereafter, obviously, I saw the other judges sitting there in the manner in which the lawyers used to argue before them, calling them my lords, your lordships, and the kind of awe-inspiring. It was more of an awe-inspiring experience for me. So that was probably, I feel, the trigger point where it triggered my motivations to become a lawyer.
Right, sir.
So...
Sir, yeah. What are the striking qualities of Setna Sahib that you can share with us? Striking qualities as an advocate, as a human, that you can share with us?
See, I'll tell you, first and foremost, I'll tell you that I owe my existence, a professional existence, to Mr. KJ Setna, because but for him, having told my father and my joining him, I would never have thought in my wildest of the wildest dreams that I would ever join this profession. But he somehow or the other, I don't know how and what, but he wanted me to join him. I joined him and the rest is history. I put in now 25 years of practice. Setna, sir, Mr. KJ Setna, at that time, he was not a senior designated lawyer, but in his own right, he was a very, very senior lawyer, very well respected. And everybody used to love him a lot. He was the president of the Gujarat Bar Association also. The striking qualities about Mr. Setna was his hardworking capacity and his honesty and his dedication to the profession. And if my memory doesn't fail me, I remember him telling me once that Jal Beta, he used to call me Jal Bikra. In Parsi, yeah. He used to tell me Jal Bikra Hu. Yes. So he used to tell me that Jal Bikra Hu, mari society na street lamp ni niche BSC ne mein law pass karelu chhe. What he meant to say was that he has passed law under the lights of a street lamp of his society. And that is the kind of hardships that he has seen in his life. And that is how he has come ahead in his life. So that was one striking characteristic of Mr. Setna, if I can say, the tenacity in him. Secondly, as a professional, if I can say that he had a very good knack of building up a good rapport with the judges during the course of a matter. And another aspect was that his tenacity as a lawyer was par excellence, par excellence. And yes, of course, he had a very bad temper at that time. And many a times we have been lucky enough to miss his targets of throwing things, whatever were there in his hands, if we asked some stupid queries to him. And if we would get angry, but with utmost humility at his command, within about 10-15 minutes, he'll come and say, sorry. Ke dikra, sorry, I got angry with you. So there are so many qualities about this man. Yes, a lot of knowledge on the criminal side, and he used to practice only on the criminal side. Most importantly, he had a very good knack of cross-examination. And he used to practice, before I joined him in 1992, he used to practice a little bit on the lower, in the lower courts also. Very good knack of cross-examinations and a very good command over law. Very good command over law. I would say that in today's era, if I have to put anybody at his par, I wouldn't be able to put anybody at par with him as far as his legal acumen on criminal side is concerned. I use par excellence.
This clearly shows how much you respect your senior.
Yes, of course. We owe our existence to them. Very whatever true. Little, but we learn a lot.
Very true, sir. And I may tell you, I had been very low junior when I had started my interaction with KJ Setna sir, but he owes to every one of us.
Very true.
He owes, and it cannot be explained in any words, sir. It is unexpressive.
Yes.
Sir, when have you actually started your, what was your first experience when you actually independently appeared before the court? First time you appeared before the court. How have you managed and what was your psychological condition then?
I'll tell you very frankly, and I'm not ashamed to say that, and I'm not even embarrassed to say that. After I finished my law at the office of Mr. Setna with in his chambers, he gave me two options at that point of time, of two lawyers, that which one of these would you join? Both of them are ready to take you. I said, sir, I don't have to choose. I will go where you put me. So he said that, okay, then I put you in the office of Mr. Prakash K. Jani, now a very senior lawyer in his own right, as well as a designated senior counsel. And the additional advocate general till now, till the time he resigned. So that is how I joined Mr. Prakash Jani in the year 1995.
Right.
I remember that the first day that I joined him, on that very day, he gave me an application and for anticipatory bail for the offense under section 302. Now just imagine,
right,
that murder, anticipatory bail,
right,
and I am put to argue before His Lordship Justice J.M. Panchal, as he then was.
Right.
And I a night before when he gave me, I actually thought that, okay, fine, I've got an opportunity to argue. So I did take up the matter, but I'll trust me, I'm telling you the truth, that by the time my number came to argue, my hands were freezing, they were cold. I'm actually telling you, my legs were shivering at that point of time. And I was at loss of words as to how will I start, what will I tell the court.
Right, sir.
Luckily for me, I was before a good court, and the court heard me very patiently. And the court said that, Mr. Unwala, we are not with you. Would you like to withdraw or would you like to have a reasoned order? So at that point of time, I didn't even know the exact importance that should I withdraw or should I take a reasoned order. Why? The logic behind that, I didn't know. So I just said that, sir, reasoned order. So Justice J.M. Panchal looked at me and smiled at me that, are you new to this profession? I said, yes, sir, today is my first day. And then he said that, but we have been seeing you with Mr. Setna. So I said, yes, my lords, I was earlier interning with Mr. Setna, but now I've joined Mr. Jani. So where is Mr. Jani? I said that, sir, he is in another court. I'll just call him. He said, okay, don't worry. We are keeping the matter at 2:45. At that point of time, the recess was from 2 to 2:45. So they kept the matter at 2:45. And Mr. Jani came. Mr. Jani was told that you will not argue a single word. We have heard your colleague. He has argued very well. Only thing is that we asked him whether he wants to withdraw or he wants a reasoned order. He said he wants a reasoned order. So Mr. Jani said that, no, my lords, still the charge sheet is not filed. So we would like to withdraw it and with a liberty to file after some time or maybe if he's arrested thereafter. So that was my first experience. But I'll tell you, Purvesh, I was actually scared, actually scared that how will I perform? I mean, my English at that point of time was also not even as good as what it is right now. But I'm not ashamed to say that I was literally shivering. That was the kind of scare that I had in my head. And let me tell you one thing more. That even today when I get up to argue, if I wouldn't say I'm scared or frightened or there is a fear, but yes, there is surely an anxiety. I'm anxious and that anxiety levels are high, not because I'll fail or I'll succeed, but only and only with a view to see that how will I perform, whether will I be able to do proper justice to my client or not. Luckily, with God's blessings, I've been able to scale through till now. But even today, that is there. And Purvesh, I'll tell you one thing, that the day that fear is gone or that anxiety levels are gone, I will give up my practice and I'll sit at home. Because for every lawyer, this anxiety or fear is necessary. True. Otherwise, what happens is that complacency sets into you. And that's not a good sign. That's the first sign of your downfall.
So what do you actually do to control this anxiety? Because even we, everyone has this anxiety, but we are actually controlled by the anxiety and cannot perform well in the court. And that's how sometimes we could not give proper justification to the matter that we are dealing with. So what do you do actually to control that anxiety so that it cannot overcome you and you can perform well before the court?
Purvesh, I use many methods. I ask many people, I talk with many seniors, and all seniors said that Jal, everybody has that, and you will have to strike out your own method and find out as to how you are able to control your anxiety. You will laugh, and everybody listening to this interaction between us will laugh.
No one will laugh, sir. You all are facing the same thing. No one will laugh. You all are facing the same thing.
No, but now that what I'm going to tell you,
yes, sir,
that will make people laugh, and that is,
yes,
that I have this lovely thing called an iPad, and I play a game of cricket on my iPad to beat my blues of anxiety.
Right.
The reason is, there is a very, very good reason that I don't like to keep on concentrating what the judge has done in the earlier matters. Because my matter stands on a different footing and I'm going to argue my matter in my own way. So what has happened in the earlier matters is not going to affect as such. No doubt that there are times when the mood of the court is different and it is consistent with all. But in order to break your anxiety, I believe that you need to divert your mind from that anxiety and those thoughts. Right. So what I do is I play a game till the time my matter is even called out, till my colleagues have to at least, they have to tell me that, sir, next matter is ours. Can I take the iPad? I would say, no, let it be called out. And I do this. And I'm telling you, this has helped me a lot. Nothing, I mean, it's not that I enjoy playing cricket at that time or something, but it at least helps me divert my mind and attention from the overthinking, the process of overthinking at that point of time as to what will happen to my matter. Right. And trust me, when I get up to argue, I'm absolutely fresh. No set motions as to what I'll argue, how I'll argue, which points to put forward. So that's how I beat that.
Right, sir. So any specific matter that you can recollect which have actually changed your career or which you can say to be a milestone in your professional career?
Yes, Purvesh. There is a list of number of matters which I can say that has actually shaped me. But one matter stands on an absolute different pedestal. And that is where in 2012, I happened to argue one matter before the full bench of the Gujarat High Court, comprising of the Honorable Chief Justice, Justice Bhattacharya, Justice B.M. Saha and Justice A.L. Dave. And that matter was a matter where I had challenged the virus of the regulations framed by the under the Electricity Act. And where I had challenged the regulation, one of the regulations on the ground, that they don't have any rulemaking powers for such a regulation. And that regulation was basically, it stipulated that the dues of the erstwhile owner
can be recovered,
had to be paid by the subsequent owner who buys the property.
Yes, sir.
And I said that, I argued before the court, and ultimately I'll tell you very frankly that my point was upheld.
Yes.
My matter was allowed.
Yes.
I was even opposed by the stalwarts at, Mr. Mihir Thakur, yes, and the present Solicitor General of India, Mr. Tushar Mehta. In spite of a lot of opposition, that matter was allowed, and that changed the course of my life. The reason, there are two reasons for that. Not because I argued it well or I argued it to the best of my ability and command and all that, but there was a confidence which I got that yes, I can argue even these kind of matters.
Right.
Now, challenging a legal provision, a regulation on the ground of constitutional validity, virus, no rulemaking power. Now, these are all really important questions which you one has to study a lot and put in a lot of labor when he argues a matter like this. But that gave me a confidence that yes, I can argue these kind of matters too. And that was the starting point of my confidence building. So I would put up this matter. That matter is pending before the Honorable Supreme Court.
Sir, I was just telling you it is pending. I hope I can continue your legacy. I'm appearing for the respondents here. And I'm hopeful that I can actually achieve your benchmark that you have done there.
So that's Thanks a million. But yeah, there are a lot of good points in that matter. But that's a different aspect. We'll discuss it later on.
Very true, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, other than Setna Sahib and Jani Sahib, whom you consider to be your idol or a mentor in the profession? Other than Setna Sahib and Jani Sahib, they are your seniors, of course, but other than them?
Purvesh, I have never idolized anybody in my life.
Mm-hmm.
As far as Mr. Setna is concerned, my guru, my I would say that my mentor, even Mr. Jani. But my temperament, my nature is totally different from the temperament and nature of Mr. Setna and Mr. Jani. Nevertheless, what we generally learn from our seniors is the methodology, the way they argue. Maybe we argue in a different style. We may have an aggressive style, or we may have a different style than theirs. But there is a method where we try to imbibe that method in us, which I have learned from both my seniors. Other than that, I have never idolized anybody.
Right.
And I have tried to maintain my own method of arguing, my own style of arguing. And probably that has helped me till date. And the meticulous manner in which Mr. Jani used to prepare matters, that is one thing which I have learned from that office, from him.
Sir, what do you expect from an advocate that briefs you on a specific matter?
Purush, I expect that at least when he comes to me, there should be no suppression of facts. The first thing.
Right.
That the AOR should not suppress any facts, either from the court or even from me. It's a different thing that by experience and by our way of putting questions to the AOR, we try to find out whether there are some things missing or not.
True.
But trust me, till date, I have never come across a single advocate briefing me trying to suppress anything. They have all been very nice and they are on the right path. That only shows one thing, that they're on the right path. Right. Secondly, I expect that he should be at least well prepared with the factual data.
Hmm.
See, what happens nowadays is that people, these young lawyers, they are damn smart. They are very well versed with law. But what happens is that marshalling of facts is something which, in the process to marshal law, at times marshalling of facts takes a backseat many a times.
Right.
So I would expect an advocate briefing me to be very thorough on facts rather than on law.
True.
Because law is now on your fingertips. You can find out law immediately. I mean, whatever law that you want.
Right.
So factually, he should be ready. And legally, obviously, I mean, legal aspects is not an issue nowadays with junior lawyers.
Hmm.
Factually, yes, I would say that they should be well prepared on facts. And well, I haven't had a bad experience with anyone till now. None.
Sir, have you ever had instance where you thought that there was no merit in the matter or brief that is being given to you?
Yes, many a times it happens. And if I feel that there is no merit in the matter and it is not worth filing, Purvish, I don't take up the matters. I'll be very open with you. That if there is no matter where I have to literally stand up and say that, sir, this matter requires a decent burial.
Hmm.
Such matters at this stage and after this many number of years doesn't really befit us to take up such matters. I mean, no, I don't take up such matters where it doesn't make sense to appear.
True. Sir, how do you prepare a matter? What procedure that you undertake to prepare a matter?
That's a very good question, Purvish, that you have asked. Purvish, I have a method irrespective of where which AOR comes to me. Once he comes and briefs me, my staff, I have a very good group of colleagues with me.
Yes, definitely, yes.
The first thing that I ask them to do is take the documents and arrange the documents chronologically.
Right.
Starting from the first date till today, till the time the matter is to be filed, arrange them. Once that is done, Purvish, you have a chronology of events which has occurred in the matter.
Hmm.
Now, once you know the chronology of events, you would immediately come to know that the event which is lacking within those chronology of events. And once that is done, you have a set of chronology in your mind that the matter and the and then the entire case has proceeded this wise.
Right.
Now, once you get that, thereafter, I try to find out the factual points, the legal points in it. Then I go on to the provisions of law. How does the matter, the facts of the matter fit into the provisions of law? Are there any lacunas which have been left by the authorities down below or by the civil court, or maybe if it's a quashing matter, what are the, whether it falls within the parameters of the guidelines laid down by the Supreme Court or not. And then last, what I do is the case law.
Right.
So chronologically arranging, then preparing a chronology of event, then the provisions of law, and then the case law. So this is how I prepare a matter. But I should say one thing. I'm lucky to have very good team in my office.
Right.
All my colleagues are fantastic. They have picked up this thing like a jiffy. And once the clients come or once the AOR comes, within a day or so, the entire matter is prepared in a teamwork. I'm lucky that way. Very lucky.
I may speak on behalf of all your juniors that they are lucky to have you as a senior, sir.
Thank you so much, Purvesh. Thanks.
So what are your hobbies, sir? And how you make and take out time to pursue your hobbies in your such a busy schedule?
Purvesh, I would have loved to continue my hobbies. I had two hobbies. One was playing cricket even after I joined the bar as a lawyer.
Right.
I used to play for the Elizabeth Gymkhana here. And I used to play for the Gujarat High Court also. And yes, I used to play a lot of billiards and snooker.
Right.
And luckily for me, I have had the opportunity of playing billiards with greats like Geet Sethi. And he also used to practice in the Elizabeth Gymkhana at that time.
Right.
And Geet Sethi, everyone knows, is a world champion. Not once, not twice, but at least I remember, as far as I know, about 7 to 8 times he was a world champion, professional world champion. So these were the two hobbies that I had. But it was in at the age of 39 or so that I consciously decided one thing, that both these hobbies were taking up a little bit of my time, because all the cricket matches and the matches, billiards, the tournaments and all, were being conducted and were on Saturdays and Sundays. So that those days I was not able to attend my office. So it was at that time that at the age of 39, I said that I want to become a judge, High Court judge. So I consciously decided that now I need to stop playing cricket as well as billiards. So I put a stop there. And from 39, now I'm 48, since last 9 years, I'm not pursuing any of my hobbies, except, as I said, on this iPad that I play cricket. That's all. Otherwise, nothing else. I would love to. But unfortunately or fortunately, whatever you say, but I'm not able to get that time. Now, I may not be technically very correct, because people say that if you really want to, you can get time.
True.
But I mean, at certain points of my life, I have become a little bit lazy as far as exercise is concerned and all. But I guess even that will have some time, and I'll again start my hobbies. Let's see how it goes further.
So anything that you have in your mind that is to be shared to the legal fraternity, anything that you have to tell us?
Yes, Purvesh, there is one thing that I would like to tell not the legal fraternity as a whole, but at least all my advocate colleagues who are junior to me and who are budding lawyers who are really desirous of making it big in this profession. I would say that for the first 10 years of their life, learning is earning. And after 10 years, they will automatically see that money follows them, fame follows them. So I believe that, and I request all the colleagues who are listening to this, that please, for first 10 years of your life, professional life, give it to your senior. Now, some may be fortunate enough that their senior is their own family member, maybe their elder brother or the father or grandfather or whosoever. But hard work, honesty, these things can't be replaced by anything. Right. I would only request one thing, that yes, dedicate those 10 years to your senior, give them the 10 years, and then see the results. That's all that, Purvish, I can say for the junior colleagues.
Sir, what changes do you expect to see in the legal fraternity post-lockdown after we all had a chance to self-introspect?
If you ask me frankly, number one, speaking for myself, I have understood the value of the time that one needs to give to one's own self.
Right.
That is one thing which I have understood. Secondly, I have an ailing father. He's 88. And he's totally bedridden. And this lockdown, this quarantine period or lockdown period, I would say, is a blessing in disguise for me. Because this is the 24th or 25th day that I've been able to be there with my father from the morning till night, 24/7. And I have understood the value of spending time with one's own loved ones and even to our own selves. So I basically feel that one thing that will change is the basic lifestyle of people. And it's a wake-up call for all of us. And it has surely given a sense of awakening in the minds of every lawyer, be it junior or senior, that one needs to give some time to the family as well as one's own self. Right. So that me time that we say, me time, is very important, and the family time is also very important. So yeah, that is one thing where I feel that the perspective of lawyers will change.
Sir, any career advice that you would like to give to me specifically, sir?
Purvish, I have been working with you since last at least how many, 6 years, 7 years? I mean, 6 to 7 years. I have found you to be a very hardworking lawyer and the very good legal acumen, and you have been working very well. I would only give you one advice, that continue the way you are doing.
Very well.
And don't deviate from this style of working, the dedication that you have been putting in. And yes, one thing that I like in you is that you don't shudder from appearing before any courts.
Right, sir.
And that is one thing that I like in you, and that one quality which I like to see in all junior lawyers, that they don't shudder away. They don't say, no, not before this court. I like that. And I would only say that's not a piece of advice also. I'm myself looking out for certain advices, to be frank with you, to better myself, because we need to better ourselves at every stage of our life.
Correct, sir.
So yeah, just continue this what you're doing. And I see a very, very long and a very, very good career for you. God bless you.
I promise I will.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Purvish.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for sparing time for me, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Purvish. Thanks.
I can't express anything with words or to this interaction, sir. Thank you very much.
True. Thank you so much, Purvish. Thank